Kindi loksajde, adhoshnaya na pasori poda, atitno.
Thank you.
incense of forgiveness, we worship you, for you have brought us close to your Father. Enriched us by your birth, purified us by your baptism, sanctified us by your crucifixion, reconciled us to the Father by your resurrection, raised us up by your ascension, and adorned us with the gifts of your Holy Spirit. Now, O Lord, accept our incense and fill us always with your sweet fragrance, so that our tongues may never cease in giving thanks to you forever.
Send you greetings. Grace be with all of you.
Praise be to God always.
Jesus, our Christ, the light of the world, our Lord and our Savior, 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 our
gospel that we're reading is actually going to be broken into two parts. Because if this is all the same chapter 21 of St. John, this Sunday's gospel and next Sunday's gospel. And so what we're going to do is next Sunday, I know it's the sound system, we're waiting for it to die. It comes on, I'm not even wearing a mic, it's only the one. So, it comes on and off, this one's plugged in. But like we told you, if we need a new sound system, the estimate is 16 grand. That we ain't got. So, we'll do the best we can. When it finally dies, I will walk up and down the middle aisle and just scream. Now, this question that our Lord asks, young man, have you caught anything? The term which is used, sometimes you'll see in the translations, will say fish. The lectionary we had for the reading today, have you caught anything to eat? In the Greek term, the word that's used literally means something to eat with bread. Kind of a strange term. But of course, in hearing it in the original Greek, anyone hearing the gospel would be completely echoing the idea of the Eucharist, just the very term being used. So that our Lord, the way it's written by St. John in the inspired text, is this unusual phrase, something to eat with bread. Bread would echo the Eucharist for anyone hearing. So we know what's being set up here is a large scene, more than just simply Jesus rose from the dead and meets his disciples. It's much larger. So we're going to lay out a few of the details of the scenario, and then next Sunday we'll talk about, in the second part of this gospel being read, the dialogue that goes on, what is being said between these disciples and our Lord. Because, of course, in this gospel today, we have three things that we want to note. Distance, completion, and epiphany. St. John uses the term manifesting himself. The word in Greek is the epiphany. So he epiphanizes himself. He manifests himself. And as I mentioned to you numerous times, when St. John writes his gospel, his intention is to fill in some of the details that the other three don't give. Understanding that after decades of this gospel being preached and being read from the other three that have been written, St. John wants to fill in those holes for the believers. And so we have a detail where he says, this is the third manifestation of our Lord taking place. The other fascinating thing about this is that this is the end of the Gospel of St. John. And you'll see next week when the Gospel ends, it, knowing the rest of the story of the Ascension and Pentecost and everything, it seems to be kind of abrupt. It finishes with these disciples on the shore of the Sea of Tiberias, of Lake Genezareth. It terminates in the church. It terminates just simply in that living reality to everyone who hears this gospel, who listens to it being read, or who reads it. It finishes by terminating in the reality to which you already belong, which we call the church, this body of Christ. We talk about the question of distance or away. And he gives us the first part, being in the waters, this distance away from the shore. And we're told that the apostles, the disciples, we don't know, we know that five of these men who are in this boat are apostles. And then we're told there's two other disciples. They may be apostles, they may be other men as part of the inner circle of our Lord. We don't know, the names aren't given. But we're told that as they're coming in, they're about 100 yards away. So what is that then, a football field? So the distance is from the shore. It's not desperately far away, but they're shouting back and forth over the water to this man that they see on the shore. But they don't recognize him as being the Lord. And this is a detail which we've talked about over these last weeks. That in coming into contact with our Lord in his glory, his resurrected state, both for the people who are recorded in the Gospels, but also for us. We tend not to recognize him at first because of the disposition of our hearts. Not because of him. He doesn't change. He's unchanging, immutable, and glorious in his eternal life. But the distance that comes in, that when they have this miraculous catch of fish, and we don't really know why they don't recognize our Lord at first. Is it because it's dawn? So is it partially just simply the darkness? It's early morning. Is it the distance, the 100 yards? Or is it that spiritual dullness of sight? We don't know. Maybe it's a combination of all three. We're not sure. But St. John wants us to make sure that he knows that it's he who is the first one who says to Simon, hey, it's the Lord. And Simon, in his impetuosity, which you see throughout the gospel, is lovely. Because he immediately jumps over the side of the boat. He doesn't even wait for the last 100 yards. He's just over the side. And the others, we're told in detail, figure that the better idea is to stay in the boat. And they row in the rest of their way. But that follows this third aspect of completion. When we use our word completion in English, we usually identify it with the word finish. You complete something, you finish something. In our minds, it's the exact same thing. But in fact, the difference between the two words, and they're both Latin in origin. So when we finish something, it means we arrive at the end of it. It's done. When we say to complete something, it means actually, well, complete the form. You fill out. Completion is filling out. And what is happening also in this Gospel of St. John is this is echoing and fulfilling the 3 years before when our Lord called these same fishermen off of these same shores of this same lake. And he said, do not be worried. I will make you fishers of men. You'll be gathering up people later on. So it echoes the end of the Gospel of St. John is a completion in that sense. The echoing. But it's also completing by the miraculous draught of fish, by pulling in these fish. So important it is, St. John gives us the number of the fish counted out, 153. And for the classical world of antiquity, numbers were really big for them. And we've mentioned to you because the numerical system in these ancient languages, Hebrew, Greek, and in the Syriac, they use the alphabetic letters to make also their numerals. So A is 1, B is 2, etc. So that you can take someone's name, calculate the number of the name because the numbers and the letters will be the same. Of course, probably most famously or infamously is the same author, St. John, writing the Apocalypse when he talks about the Antichrist, that his name is 666. So this number 153 is also important because 1 plus 5 plus 3 gives you 9. And 9 is 3 times 3. Now, St. Augustine will do an entire sermon on just the numerical values. Don't worry, we're not going to do that. But the 3 is the sacred number for much of the classical world, and certainly among the Hebrews, 3 and 7 are the two most sacred numbers that come up. So that you have 3 times 3 is the notion of completion and fulfillment of our Lord manifesting himself. And echoing in this completion, the call to be fishers of men. But he's also going to echo and complete the fact that when they get on the shore, he gives us a detail. There's a charcoal grill, barbecue going. This is also echoing. There's only 2 occasions in the entire New Testament we talk about burning charcoal. And this occasion is one of them. And the other one is echoing from earlier in this Gospel of St. John, the charcoal that was burning in the high priest's courtyard where Peter was the night of our Lord's arrest. And we know the tragedy around that fire was Peter to deny our Lord three times. Don't know the man, cussing and swearing. I told you before, I don't know him. So that's going to echo as part of this completion also. So we have bread echoing the Last Supper. We have this charcoal grill that our Lord has set up on the shoreline, which is echoing one from over just a month before. So there's a notion of completion. And St. Jerome then will talk about these fish. And St. Jerome in the 4th century, he claims, that the zoologist in the area said that there are 153 species of fish in the lake. So St. Jerome uses this number again and says, therefore this net represents the collecting of all out of this lake, signifying the indication of all the nations of the earth that are to be gathered up into the church. Again, the significance, they say that even though it was such an enormous catch, the net is not torn. The church is one, it's whole. All these little details that St. John is giving us. And the last is that this is a movement of men on water to a shoreline. And all of the fathers interpret this as the waves, the water, has always represented, the sea represents the commotion, the instability of life in this world. And so the apostles in fishing on this boat are still very much in this world. And in their fishing, they bring in nothing all night long. It's also an aspect of the frustration of living in this world. Things don't often, certainly not usually, sometimes they do, turn out the way we want them to. So there's an aspect of the instability, the commotion, where they represent that our Lord on the shore is that stability, that immutability of the life of glory, of the life of eternity, and what is meant to be our participation in stability by the life of grace. So we have a contrast between these two. And then what we finish is this idea of the manifestation. That's what I leave you with for the last detail. St. John, as we mentioned to you, gives 7 miracles in his Gospels. They're all highly geared to be pedagogical. They're meant to teach. So when he says this is the third manifestation, he wants us to understand something about these three that he has chosen. Because this is the third one, and it's the end of his gospel. And it's finishing with the disciples and the catch, the reality of the church. So it's an ecclesiastical manifestation, if you like. So who are the other two? Well, the first is the beautiful recording of our Lord's epiphany, manifestation to Mary Magdalene, when she famously thinks he's the gardener, etc. That is the first manifestation, even before the apostles. He appears to this woman that we are told in the gospel earlier had been possessed by 7 demons. This woman's previous life had been quite notorious and quite painful for her personally. And in his life of glory and of healing of the resurrection, he appears to her first. The second manifestation we had just recently with Delling Thomas, the week after Easter. Put your finger in my hands, put your hand in my side, and be no longer weak in faith, disbelieve me, but believe. Understand what's going on here. So he appears first to someone who had come from a very painful and broken background, spiritually, a laywoman. He appears to one of his apostles who doesn't quite get it unless it's personally proven to him, Doubting Thomas. And then this third manifestation is going to be ecclesiastical. And that's what we're going to look at next week, the dialogue that goes on between them. Quite famous, quite well known, and that our faith terminates in this ecclesiastical reality that we are sitting in right now. You are brothers and sisters, you belong to one body of Christ, that we have received the faith from our previous generation, contact with others, who have received from before them, back to this episode that we read about today, 2,000 years earlier. This manifestation continues to this day. And what is given to us as that treasure is we are only the last link in this historical chain from this episode on the shore. And St. John is asking for us also to participate in the manifestation of Christ, and as a link in this chain, that we bring it to others, so that the same gospel will be read and understood and believed in the year 2110, when we're all pushing up daisies. That linkage, manifestation, is part of that reality of the life of grace given to us. It is a gift. It is an awesome responsibility. It does inspire awe. But it's one that he stands in stability of life and grace to give us the ability to participate in and then to give to others. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit, amen.
Ah!
out of their love fervently for your holy name, shower your spiritual blessings upon them, and in place of their earthly gifts, grant them life and your kingdom.
Thank you.
accept our prayers. Make us children and heirs of your kingdom through the grace of your only Son and his love for all people, and through your Holy Spirit now and forever.
Demandez
diatiki fadato, dhamma fagu vatva sanye, mete shedu meti heba, chosoyam hareva chai dhara ami.
Church, which you have redeemed.
Gather her children into unity, love, and faith, and guide them in peace and security. We offer it for the pure bishops of the true faith, Francis, the Pope of Rome, Bishop Peter, our Patriarch of Antioch, Nisrana Peter, our retired Patriarch, Gregory John, our Bishop, the venerable priests, the chaste deacons, the pure subdeacons, and all the orders of the Church. Teach them the word of truth so that they may spread it faithfully. With justice and holiness, may they care for the flock that you have entrusted to them. Give them the proper means to accomplish your will and grant them a long life. We pray to you, O Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For the poor and dejected, for orphans and widows, for the sick and distressed, for those tempted by evil spirits, be the guardian and refuge of their lives. We pray to you, O Lord. Solid rock of true faith, and center vocations to the holy priesthood and religious life. In a world of distractions which pull us away from properly loving you and our neighbor, may those whom you have called to serve your holy church respond to you and have the courage to follow your will. We pray to you, O Lord. Remember the holy fathers, prophets, apostles, preachers, evangelists, martyrs, and confessors, especially the holy, glorious, and blessed ever-Virgin Mary, Mother of God, St. John the Baptist, the messenger and forerunner who witnessed the betrothal of your holy church to your Son, glorious St. Stephen, the archdeacon and first martyr, and all who pleased you and profess your holy name. We pray to you, O Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For all the faithful departed who have gone to you from this altar and from every place throughout the world, grant them rest in your heavenly dwellings with all your saints, and in your mercy forgive our sins and theirs.
Amen.
beginnings of your eternity. And he accomplished his plan of salvation for us, that we may come to you. May we call upon you with the prayer that he taught his holy disciples, saying, Our Father,
who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. The kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen.
Yes, O merciful Lord, we ask for your compassion. By your grace, make us worthy that your glorious name may be made holy in us, that your kingdom come to assist us in our weakness, and that your will dwell within us. Deliver us from all difficult temptations. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours with your only Son and your Holy Spirit, now and forever.
Amen.
Peace be with you.
And with your spirit.
Bow your heads before the God of mercy, before his forgiving altar, and before the body and blood of our Savior, who gives life to those who partake of him, and receive the blessing from the Lord.
O Lord God, you are good and lover of all people. Look upon those who bow their heads before your majesty, and bless them with every spiritual blessing. Do not turn us away when we approach your divine and holy gifts, and let us not be guilty of unworthily receiving the body and blood of your only Son. Rather, make us worthy to share in your holy and life-giving mysteries with purity, that we may raise glory and thanks to you, to your only Son, and to your good and Holy Spirit, now and forever.
Amen.
The grace of the Most Holy Trinity, eternal and consubstantial, be with you, my brothers and sisters, forever.
And with your spirit, let each one of us look to God with reverence and humility and ask him for mercy and compassion.
Holy gifts for the holy, with perfection, purity, and sanctity.
One Holy Father, one Holy Son, one Holy Spirit, blessed be the name of the Lord, for he is one in heaven and on earth. To him be glory forever. Make us worthy, O Lord God, so that our bodies may be sanctified by your holy body, and our souls purified by your forgiving blood. May our communion be for the forgiveness of our sins,
Lord Jesus, you have made us worthy to share in your holy body and in the cup of salvation. How can we repay you for these your gifts and graces and for your goodness? As you have called us to approach this life-giving banquet, make us worthy, so that your body may be mingled with our bodies, and your blood with our souls for the pardon of faults, the forgiveness of sins, and for eternal life. You are blessed and your kingdom is holy. We raise glory to you, to your Father, and to your Holy Spirit, now and forever. Amen. Peace be with you. God the Father, we bow before you and entrust ourselves to your care. We ask you, imploring your mercy, to rest your right hand, full of blessings upon us. Assist us, protect us, bless us, and sanctify us by the holy cross of your only Son. We glorify and honor you, your only Son, and your Holy Spirit, now and forever.
Amen.
Go in peace, my beloved brothers and sisters, with the nourishment and blessings you have received from the forgiving altar of the Lord. May the blessing of the Most Holy Trinity accompany you, the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit, the one God, to whom be glory forever.